Hello and welcome back to Running on Pixie Dust. I am your host, Annika. Give me a follow on socials at Annika Hudak or on Instagram where I post the most daily, pretty much, at Annika's Paintbrush. Welcome back to season two of Running on Pixie Dust. We've had some updates lately about a little thing called a knee injury, but really it's kind of like my whole body that just needs a little help. If you're new here, welcome. Be sure to check out episode zero for my full story for even starting to align this podcast with Dopey Challenge training for this past January, where I completed the Dopey Challenge for the very first time. Incredible. I love sharing everything I learn along the way on this podcast and giving you guys updates as well as life in Orlando. So I'm always excited to come on here and share. Disclaimer, I am not a coach, not affiliated with anyone. This is just for fun, sharing my personal experiences and opinions. And with all that said, welcome to episode 25. Yeah, we're getting these episodes out pretty quickly. I think I've been pretty good about it recently because I started season one on such a good like weekly schedule, and now season two has kind of just been all over the place and whenever I feel like it, but it's fine. It's all fine. Also, I might sound like extra lispy today because I'm doing round two of my Invisalign because I started it, honestly, like when Dopey training started, like for last year, and I went through and finished the cycle, but my teeth like were stubborn, so they weren't done yet, and so I had to get new molds done, and they had to order me a whole new set, basically, and so now I'm on round two. It took months for these freaking aligners to come in, and so I literally just started it again this past week, so now I'm extra dish free again, and I had to get used to getting the brackets put back on, and they're in different spots now too, so it's just like, it's an adjustment, but I'm trying to be really good about wearing them all the time, so I just have to deal with it. So that's what you have to deal with too. If you're watching on YouTube, you notice my little shirt? It's got a little Dumbo, like a Squishmallow. It's like a Squishmallow shirt. And it has a bunch of characters on it. I only show the top half of it. But I think I'm going to take it with me to Disneyland. Because I obviously have to take all the Dumbo things. And I think I got this in like Hong Kong Disneyland maybe. Like years ago. So I love finding little things that I pick up along the way. Not knowing how like fun and perfect they'll be for certain weekends. Like Dumbo, for example. So I just love when that happens, which is why I can't get rid of anything also, because what if I need it in the future? Which it kind of explains the ear wall behind me if you're watching on YouTube as well. It's because like, well, what if I need this? Like, I'm going to regret getting rid of something and wishing I had it for like a perfect moment like that. So anyway, welcome to episode 25. We got my highs and lows. Highs, I started physical therapy. That's a big high because it is a step in the right direction, but it's tied in with the lows because it's just I'm on the road to recovery right now. If you missed it, I have a knee injury situation happening right now. I covered it in the last two episodes. It just started as like a clicking pain. Or not even pain, it was just clicking and popping, and that means nothing to me because I pop everywhere, but then it became painful. It took a month to finally get it checked out and seen by all these different doctors, and my Hoffa's fat pad is inflamed, as well as I've got a little bit of misalignment, and I learned even more about my body at physical therapy this week, so I'm going to share all that with you too. So it's been a journey. I haven't run in weeks, and it's killing me slowly. I also don't know when I can run again yet. And the fact that we are less than 90 days away from Dopey is giving me so much anxiety, but I'm trying not to let it completely overcome me. So that's that. Lows, can't really do any dedicated like walking workouts to even keep up with training right now. It's so hard because the type of injury I have with my knees being inflamed, doing anything that like caused the injury in the first place, which is kind of like a combination of a bunch of things, which I covered in the last episode, which is kind of like my supinating of my feet turning outwards, the opposite of pronating, wearing kind of too stability of a shoe, which is why I'm not wearing my Hoka Gaviota 4s anymore. That had also, in addition to that, the custom inserts that I had, which over time pushed me outward. And because of my gait changing, my body changing, it just wasn't working for me. Slash a lot of training, slash genetics, and slash not enough strength training in the places where I'm really weak personally. So we learned all that the hard way. But all that to say is I can't really do the walking, the aqua jogging, running, obviously, or even biking, because that is putting my knee in the motion that got it injured in the first place. So thankfully no tears, thankfully no stress fractures, thankfully no surgery, thankfully dumpy is not off the table. And I'm not going to let it get off the table. And I'm trying to sit here, sit on my hands and just rest, do what my body needs, strengthen all my weak points where I can to get back to it. So clearly that's just like my biggest low right now. It's affecting me so much. And it's especially so hard too when I look on my Strava app, which is where I track all my runs and have all my workouts synced to. It's not even the fact that like I see all my friends that I train with like getting their runs in because I'm like so proud of them. It's not that at all. Like it's more about me seeing my like monthly mileage be nothing compared to what it was months ago, and seeing like the downward trend of like, oh, this is where you are. And like notification of like, here, you got in 1 mile this week. Oh, thanks, Strava. Thanks for that. I didn't know, really. Like, they need to put like a I'm injured toggle on there and a leave me alone feature while I'm recovering. So that's hard. But I love keeping up with all my friends and seeing everyone else still sticking strong to training, which makes me really happy and really sad at the same time, because I'm so happy for you and not at all jealous. But it's hard too, because like I don't want to miss park visits, which like I'm okay with, honestly, like sitting out at the Disney parks. Like I live here, it's fine. I'm gonna live without going and like doing a ton of walking at the parks. Like it's gonna be okay. But we had a work outing at Epcot this past weekend, and we did one lap around the world, which is honestly, it's still a lot of walking. Like we were there for like the evening. We were definitely there for a solid amount of time, and it was a bit of walking. I preemptively like put KT tape on my knee to essentially like shift my kneecap over inward where it's like can be more aligned, and I wore the knee brace. And even then, like, my legs are very tired at the end. Like, I probably could have done without a little bit of that. But it's hard because, like, I want to be included and I'm meeting a bunch of people that, like, I need to know and, like, work with. And so that FaceTime is really, really important, and to be present at these kinds of things. But it's hard when you're struggling with an injury. So that was tough. But, I mean, it was still fun. I'm glad I could still go. Halloween Horror Nights, like, ugh, I want to get the use out of my pass, and, like, there's still things that, like, I haven't done, and so going each time, I think I've been probably 5 times now, and that's the point of, like, why you get frequent fear pass is so that you can go and do each thing a little bit at a time and not have to spend, like, a whole night there, and, like, do things that you want to do and can redo things that you want to do like that, but so it's just making it more difficult to like sit out and sit on the bench and lay in bed and do nothing kind of thing, because that's not what I want to be doing. So all that to say, my final low, money. My golly, running has been the most expensive thing to ever happen to me. That's really dramatic. And honestly, probably not true because your girl was a dancer and in pageants. So those things are also very expensive. But my goodness gracious, physical therapy is going to cost me a small fortune. Like, even with pretty good insurance that I have through my work, and I pay a lot of money weekly out of my paycheck for that. Even with insurance, it's so freaking expensive. Like, my first visit was over $100, and every visit after that, I think, was like $85. So, like, every time I go, it's $85. And so this is all this, like, medical bills are racking up because I had to pay to, I honestly, I haven't even seen the bills yet for seeing my primary care to get the referral, but I had to pay before I was even seen by the specialist, the orthopedic doctor, and that was $40 each time. So it's like, okay, now we're in the hundreds dollar mark. That didn't even make sense. The hundreds of dollars realm already just to get diagnosed and just to get me to the road of recovery, to get me started. And that's not even including the $147 I had to pay for my freaking knee brace. And I was talking to the guy who, like, brought in the knee brace and, like, was getting me fitted at the office, like, while I was still there. And he said, because of the billing codes, my insurance wasn't going to cover it, which is really annoying. Because, again, like, okay, what am I paying all this money for this insurance for? But he was like, well, we could try and find you a similar one on Amazon. Like, obviously, there's going to be cheaper alternatives out there, but nothing that, like, was exactly what I was needing. Like, it's a very particular kind of knee brace. It is meant to artificially push my kneecap into alignment. So it's actually physically shoving my kneecap over and helping me when I walk. So while I could go on Amazon and find, like, a $20 version of this, it's not, like, the ones I was looking at just weren't going to be it. It's like, well, do I want to skimp on this? No. Like, I want to get back to training. And so that was so frustrating. Like, okay, I have to pay this nearly $150 for this stupid brace. So there's that. Like, oh, it's killing me. But I know it's, you got to invest in yourself, invest in your health now, pay now or pay later. But honestly, in my case, I might be paying all around every time, now and later, forever. So, yeah. I know your body is the best thing you can invest in, though. So that's what I keep telling myself when I have to pay these things. At this point, it's just debt-free journey who, because I can't even focus on putting any extra money towards paying down my debt. Because if you didn't know, I'm on a debt-free journey, paying off six figures of student loans. And it's tough. It's tough out here. I'm a single mother to my beagle daughter, Cinnamon. And running in itself, new running shoes, race, fees, travel, running gear, all of that is also not cheap. So that's just, like, my little rant of course I'm choosing to enter this realm and this sport, but it's frustrating. It's tough. If anyone else out there has money trauma and wants to rant about anything, I'm your girl. I love venting and I love sharing too much information. So there you have it. Speaking of my MRI too, I got a letter that was sent by my insurance to my orthopedic doctor, and I was just CC'd on it for awareness, I guess, that they were asking, was my MRI even medically necessary? Like, bro, shut up. Like, just, like, my doctor ordered it. Why would he order it if it wasn't medically necessary? Like, goodbye. Anyway, my first physical therapy appointment. Let's talk about it. I had done physical therapy in the past. If you didn't know, I was a dancer for 10 years, and I was on point with the point shoes on the toes. I was on point for 4 of those years in high school, and I had been training for our fall ballet or our winter ballet and the Nutcracker. And I was in, like, the Arabian attendant position. And if you don't know anything about the Nutcracker Ballet, there's this scene with the Arabian dancers. That's just like what they were called. And obviously it stems from like the whole story of the Nutcracker. But all you really need to know is I was this one part that the requirement for this like section of the show was flexibility. So we had like our main person and then we were like the background dancers, and you had to basically just do flexibility on stage. It was like splits, leg holds, holding back bends, and all of these things that were really hard on your body. And especially if you only do them one-sided, you kind of start favoring certain parts of the body. And so I got like really bad shoulder tendonitis because I had to hold this like back bend situation for like multiple 8 counts of this dance and like rehearsing it over and over and over again. And that was like a lot of stress on my body. So I had to like take a break from dance at that point too. And I had to get PT for that tendonitis going down my shoulder blade, which still affects me to this day. It's just not something that goes away. But I did have to go for that, as well as like I have back issues for my whole life, basically. So it's fun being me. I have a sway back. I also got a pinched nerve in college. And if you've had a pinched nerve in your back, do I feel for you? I could not get out of bed. And like, I wish I was being dramatic. And like, if you've ever had this happen to you, you know I'm not being dramatic. Like, you physically cannot move. You're essentially paralyzed, because if you move, it's such a sharp, stabbing pain that like, you literally can't move. And so I remember this so distinctly. I woke up and I like had to get my roommate to physically get me out of bed and take me to the hospital. Like, I was so stressed. But all that to say is my body is so old feeling. Like, I'm so crickety and I have disc degeneration in my spine. And like, I have, again, such curvature in my back and hip problems and sciatica problems. And like, I could just keep going. We could be here all day. And like, and yet I choose to run. So, crazy. But anyway, this wasn't my first dabble with physical therapy. But it's been a long time, and you know, not every place does the same. So first off, even finding a physical therapy location was going to be the bane of my existence, which is, it's always frustrating with the American healthcare system, finding care soon, because there's always going to be someone who can fit you in, you know, a couple months from now. What am I supposed to do between those, like now and then? I don't know. Just suck it up and deal, which is unfortunately the case for, I'm sure, many people, and that sucks. Like, why can't we be better about that? Okay, I'm not going to get into it. I'm going to get fired up. But anyway, through my referral that I got from my orthopedic doctor to a physical therapist, I called the places he recommended, and like in the same, not even the same health network, because there's a lot of places that are in network but don't have like the same overarching like name, like Orlando Health, for example. I called every Orlando Health physical therapy office, every single Orlando Health office for physical therapy in the area, which none of them are by my house, by the way. and none of them could get me in. Like, the soonest they could get me in was going to be 2 weeks. So I was going to have to sit here for another 2 weeks not having anything, and so that wasn't going to work. I tried to get a hold of my insurance. That was already a nightmare. I had to call like several different numbers. One of them connected me to like a Spanish line, and it wasn't even like my general insurance number. Like, it was just so weird. Like, there was so much friction trying to just get a hold of my insurance. Like, what? And I literally had to talk to people, and I was like, I don't know how I got transferred to like the Spanish line, but I never pressed a Spanish option. Like, I was just trying to find someone who speaks English and who can help me. Like, please. And she transferred me, and then it hung up, of course. So don't you just love that? Don't you love it when they hang up on you? So probably took me a couple hours to even get a number to get to someone to then send me a PDF of all of the physical therapy offices covered by my insurance, like, or in network of my insurance. And it wasn't even like a searchable thing because, oh, don't worry, I try and I'm can be very resourceful. I'm studied computer science. I know how to work a freaking web browser and I can search online for doctors that I need. But the problem was I couldn't do that for finding my physical therapy options. Long story short, I had to go this route and I get emailed a PDF of like all the different addresses, but all I get is like the doctor name and then the address and a phone number. And it's just a PDF of like hundreds of locations and it's not sorted by city or anything. So kind of do it the old fashioned way, do a little command F, search for like places near me and give them, you know, cold call one by one to see who could fit me in. Thankfully, after all of this, I finally found an office that is like 5 minutes from me. Thank the freaking Lord. And I gave them a call. They could get me in. This was a Tuesday. They could get me in on Thursday this past week. So thank goodness. Oh my gosh. I almost cried because of how much effort I had to go through for that. But they could get me in on Thursday. I said, great. They always ask like what time of day is like best for you, what days are best for you, and I'm always like, as soon as you can get me in, like that's when is best for me. And so I went. She gave me a thorough exam, and you always have to fill out those like in-depth questionnaires and like point on the drawing of a body, like point where it hurts and mark off like where you feel pain and all that. So I did all that. But the reason I'm explaining this is because I have to talk about this thorough exam that she did of just gauging like where everything is on my body and like where my alignment is and like taking a look at my knees, especially because of my diagnosis of my like maltracking of my kneecap on my left knee pointing outwards. She like really wanted to pay attention to alignment of everything, and she noticed that like I'm very knock-kneed, which, hello, I've known my whole life because like I can just look in the mirror and see that that my knees always like push together, like my knees will touch before my ankles do, and that's just the way it is. Like that's something I've always had to deal with. And in ballet, whenever you're in, if you know, sixth position, which is literally just your feet parallel touching facing forward, my knees always press against each other really hard when I put my feet together. And so that's like something I've always like worked on my alignment in ballet. Like I know kind of how to align myself, but obviously it's been years since I have taken ballet because I stopped that like years and years ago. But anyway, all that to say is, yeah, girl, I know I'm knock-kneed. Like, thank you. But something I actually didn't notice was my left knee is a little bit more knock-kneed than my right. And I don't know if it's just because, you know, you look at yourself every day in the mirror and you don't notice some of these things sometimes, but it is. It totally is. And it like was pushing inward more. So that like, as we were standing there, they had a mirror in the office and she was like, yeah, I noticed like your knee on the left side pushes in a little bit more. And that was such an interesting moment for me. I was like, oh, it does. And then she felt like the alignment of my pelvis, my left hip is higher than my right. And so there's like a lot of things happening that like clearly are contributing to my knee issues. And so it was just so interesting to like figure all of this out. And she did a couple of like, you know, the hip flexor test and like how far you can extend your legs forward and like measure it per side and compare. And apparently I have tight ankles. What? And like obviously like that can contribute to having tight calves and or like shin splints, which I haven't really been having any shin splint issues, but I have had them in the past, especially like last year with training when I got into the higher mileage. So it was just really interesting to get all of this feedback and like broken down for me and like look at it and actually be like, this is what's going on here, and this is how it's all connected. So that was just so crazy to me. she also like took a look at my arches of my feet and was like, well, they look pretty normal to me. Like, I've definitely seen higher arches, but you know, it's I would agree with that statement. Like, I always say, like, I have the highest arches ever, and like I do have like high arches. Like, I've also seen people with higher arches, and but like they don't have the issues I do. So it's like my arches are a higher vibe. How about that? So yeah, it was just kind of mind-blowing for her to like point all these things out and like be like, well, this is what we need to work on. And I told her what my ortho doctor told me, that we've got to strengthen the VMO muscle, which is that special teardrop muscle on like your inner quadricep kind of, and stretch the IT band, and obviously strengthen hip flexors and glutes and fill in the blank, strengthen everything else. And she was like, okay. And as I was laying there, she was like, so we're a little tight here, we're tight here, we need to strengthen here, we're weak, we're here, you can't extend fully here, so we kind of just need to work on everything. So I will say, me paying the small fortune for physical therapy, I think will be really good for me because of all of these issues that she listed off for me. And it's interesting too, because when she was walking me through some of the exercises, in the moment it doesn't feel like they're doing much, and they're such like simple little exercises, but like I can actually feel them working. And obviously over time we want to get those areas strengthened and good and strong so that they don't feel weak doing these exercises. But it was just crazy. So she gave me a set of exercises, and I had like talked her through, I'm doing dopey, and she knew what dopey was, and she was like, oh, okay. And then I was like, well, you're gonna hate me for this next one, because guess what, I'm also doing Dumbo the following weekend. And she was like, okay. Ideally we want to get me out of the knee brace and like not needing it, but highly likely I'm gonna need to wear the brace throughout both race weekends, which I knew, like, I don't think I can get away from that. Like, yeah, that makes sense. So I was like very eager, and I was like, okay, like, give it to me, like, I can take it, like, give me a whole workout, I can do it 7 times a day, like, please fix me, get me back, like, we can do this. And so she gave me like 3 strength exercises and 2 like stretches to do twice a day. And I've been doing them, feeling good. And I honestly, like, I feel it in places I'm not used to feeling it. Like, I'm feeling it now, Mr. Krabs. And it's wild, where you wouldn't think like simple little exercises like that are doing much, because they're not these like crazy strenuous things, but like they really are helping you. So I'm sticking to it. I'm very diligent about it, and I want to get back to it. I asked her if, like, what do you think about me, like, walking? What about, like, what else can I be training outside of these exercises? She said, you know, obviously stick to upper body and, you know, arms, core, which is definitely what I'm doing. And I think there's, like, glute exercises I can do that don't really require, like, load bearing and aggressive knee bending, things like glute bridges, which I can definitely do, things like RDLs, like, you don't really have to like significantly bend your knees for things like those. So I'm working on what I can, so we shall see. The goal is to go back to physical therapy twice a week for 12 weeks, essentially, because I think my doctor ordered 3 times a week for 4 weeks, but after talking with her in like that office, she was like, well, we can do 2 a week for 12 times, or 12 visits, basically. So 12 weeks. Wow, can I talk? But so that's a long time. But I mean, I hope we can get back to it. I honestly, like, with the strength that I've been doing, I do feel motivated and I feel good, and I know strength training will help me so much with getting back to running. Like, while I'm not doing the actual running because I can't, I'm trying to keep hope. I'm trying to keep the spirits lifted. And I know, like, it will be okay. It will be okay. Like, I can survive. And I love receiving messages from a few of you who have reached out too, who kind of went through either something similar, something exact, something kind of in the same realm where you were able to focus on strength training and you were still able to kind of survive dopey weekend and push through and feel better. So it's giving me hope. And that's what I'm holding on to for dear life. So in the meantime, I am soaking up all of the running content and I am rooting for my friends who are still training, and I'm here to tell you, you better be training. And Wine and Dine is coming up. I know that's really exciting for many people. I think it worked out that like I'm not registered for it because I won't be here, but I think I would have been panicking had I been registered for Wine and Dine and this had happened, because that would have really set me low. like I don't think I would have been able to run it. Like, that's in a couple weeks. So I probably would have had to just sit it out, which would made me really sad, because one, those are really expensive races, and two, like, that would have been something I was already mentally committed to, so that again would be tough. So I think it worked out for the best that I am not running Wine and Dine, even though I couldn't if I had wanted to in many aspects, but it's gonna be okay. But it's funny too when I see people posting like, oh, that was a tough one, or like, I don't want to run today, or like, give me some advice or give me some motivation, tell me to just get up and do it. And my response is always, I would do anything to get up and run right now. Like, I would do anything to be in your position and be complaining about having to run. Like, anything. I would love to have a long run right now. I would love to be getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning and going and getting my run done, because I want to get back out there so bad. So bad. So do it for me. Go get your run done. Do it for me, because I am very jealous and I would love to be in that, like, it hurts so good moment right after a good long run. So do it for those who wish that they could. Anyway, again, soaking up all the running content. I'm like deep into some run TikTok. Especially with Chicago Marathon coming up. That's tomorrow, which is so exciting as I'm recording this. And I love sorting through all types of different running content. And I say that because I came across, I'll say, like, videos and articles that kind of make me angry when it comes to running, and things that I try and stay away from, because it's just the attitude. I'm not going to name any names. It's just the attitude of that, like, oh, I don't care about winning. Like, I just show up and do it for me, which partially makes me really angry, because, okay, if you don't care at all about winning, why are you here racing? Like, these are, like, elite people that are racing. And it's like, okay, well, why are you here racing then? Like, don't say you don't care about winning at all, because it's like, some part of you must care because you're here racing. So, like, that kind of pisses me off that that message is being shared, and also downplaying all the hard work that we know you're putting in, but you are choosing to be like, it's not that big of a deal. Like, I don't know. I guess I don't even know where I'm trying to go with that, but some of the messages that are shared are just, they piss me off. It's giving pick me. It's giving, I'm not like other runners. Like, I'm a chill runner and I don't even care if I win. Like, who cares? And who cares about all these, like, role models out here? It's like, well, like, clearly you do, because you're choosing to be one of them. Like, I don't know. Like, I can definitely get on board with running for you and not wanting to be competitive and, like, not wanting to do this for other people and not wanting to be a spokesperson. But, like, for the people that are choosing to do that and then still choosing to share that messaging, it's just, I don't, that doesn't add up to me. Like, no, I see right through it. It's a little icky to me. So I'll just leave it at that. Like, if you're gonna do running for you, like, do the running for you, and, like, you downplaying your own hard work sounds like something that's a you thing, but don't be standing up on a pedestal being a role model for other people and being like, and also downplaying your work, because then other people are going to think that like they're not going to fully understand all of the hard work you're actually doing to be like, oh, it's nothing. Like, I don't know. My two cents. That's just me. So I read that content and I watch that kind of content just to kind of form an opinion on it. And I think take away from it what I want, which is, I mean, what I think everyone should do, and take everything with a grain of salt that they read and see online and what's shared on social media. But I don't, something about it just made me real icky. Anyway, it had me thinking about, like, all of this content had me thinking about what, like, future marathons I can see myself running. I really, really want to run New York one day. I would love to run Boston. Like, I would love to get, like, the 6 stars of all of the world majors, of all the major marathons, which would be really awesome. And it kind of gets me into a spiral, though, of, like, oh, I need to do that right now then. Like, I've got to get training, and I got to get registered, and I got to figure out how everything happens. And it's like, okay, I can relax. Like, it's not going to happen next month. Like, we're not going to get there in, like, an hour. It's fine. Like, we can relax. But it's hard, too, because with things like that, you really have to plan pretty far in advance. So it had me thinking, like, when do I want to get into New York, and when would I want to try and plan these things out? And, like, this is going to have to be, like, years in the making. But at the same time, I'm, like, still kind of on that, like, lower intermediate level where I have experience running, but I'm not in any way, shape, or form a fast runner. So, not that you need to be fast to run any of these marathons, but, like, for me personally, I would love to work on getting a little bit faster and a little bit stronger and overall more athletic to feel stronger during those races. So, does that mean I need to take a step back from running full marathons for a little bit and work on my base and kind of get stronger on half marathons, for example? So all of these things are running through my mind. Do I skip Dopey next year and just focus on just total body strength? Like, what should I do? Like, this is what's running through my mind at all time, by the way. So we shall see. To be continued. Moving on to my final segment, by the numbers, we've got countdowns. Dopey, like I said, is literally less than 90 days away. That makes me very stressed. We're 2 months and 27 days away. Holy crap. Dumbo, 3 months and 4 days away. Princess is 4 months and 15 days away. I've got no pace update for you. I've got no total mileage. We'll get back there. Next episodes, I will continue sharing my little rehabilitation journey and road back to Dumpy. But if you have anything that you want me to cover in the meantime, don't be afraid to leave a comment on YouTube, and or I think you can leave like little what did you think about this episodes on Spotify now too, and or DMs on Instagram. Would love to hear from you. But all that to say, thanks so much for tuning in and get movin'.